It starts with an empty desk. So there are specifications maybe on the desk. So there's this sheet with specifications. And what is more important, there is no circuit, so you can do no simulations. You cannot optimize the design. You cannot tweak existing hardware. So you have nothing but specs. And now we have to go through the full circle to do the design. And we will use a design example in the design assignment. So the design example that we will be using in the course and for the bonus assignment, what is it? What will the example be? Well, first, our customer. Well, our customer are radio astronomers. And what do the radio astronomers want to have? Well, they want to do interferometrics in space. They want to measure radio signals in space. And there are several space systems that can do that. So there has been a satellite sent to the moon. It's a moon orbit with NCLA and CLE on it, which has a radio receiver for low frequencies of the Radboud University. And we are expecting measurements anytime. Somewhere in 2022, we want to build a little interferometer in space with three satellites that can form a synthesis radio telescope. Later, we hope to put a little rover on the moon that we are already building at the moment, that with a few of them can form a radio telescope at the far side of the moon called LUFAR. And we want to have a swarm of nanosatellites in moon orbit that can build can be a huge radio telescope for low frequencies in moon orbit. And what do we want to measure? Well, this is what we want to measure. We want to measure the hydrogen line. And it works like this, that when you have hydrogen, then hydrogen can have two energy states. And the energy states depend on the spin of the electron that is in orbit around the nucleus of the hydrogen atom. So when they are in the same, spinning in the same direction, you have a higher energy state than when you're in a lower state with lower energy. And when there is a flip, so from the high to the low energy state, the hydrogen atom emits a photon, and the photon is at 1420 megahertz. And the universe is full of hydrogen. So at some point, close after the Second World War, a radio astronomer in the Netherlands proposed to listen to the hydrogen lines coming, the hydrogen photons frequencies coming from space to see the structure of the universe. And here you see a picture of the universe as a function of time. And what happens is when a photon leaves the hydrogen from a hydrogen atom, it depends on where it is in space, how we will receive it over here. Because we know that the universe is expanding, and we know that objects that are further away from us are expanding faster than objects that are closer to us. And this gives the so-called redshift. It's a Doppler effect. So this means that if you look at this picture, where this is present day, and this is the history of the universe, and this is the Big Bang, then a photon that was emitted here and arrives at us has a lower frequency than a photon, say, that is coming from the sun. So when we look at the universe and we look at the hydrogen lines, we see the structure of hydrogen, but from the frequency of the hydrogen, we know how far the object is and how old the object is. And the lower the frequency from the hydrogen, the farther away we look in space, and the older the signals are. And now the problem for everybody is that when we go to the deepest space, so when we want to look at the Big Bang, the frequencies have become so low that we cannot receive them with radio telescopes on Earth. So we need to look at redshifted hydrogen that is from far away in the past. And unfortunately, only one image has been made, and this one image has been made with a satellite called Radio Astronomy Explorer 2 that was in moon orbit. And it was found that when it was in a moon orbit and at the far side of the moon, it could create this map. And this map was measured at 4.7 megahertz. And this is the only measurement we have. And if you look at the satellite, then it is, if you take the antennas into account, still the largest satellite that was ever launched, because it has antennas of a few hundred meters to be able to receive that low frequencies in space. And this is the only map of the sky we have at those frequencies. And you see some structure over there, but nobody knows if these structures come from an exoplanet or if they are from the early universe that gives us the first structure and gives us a way to find out how galaxies originated and so on. So we want more and we want more details. But unfortunately, receiving this frequency in space is very difficult because of those large antennas. And we need to have shorter antennas when we go to space. If we look at antennas, we know that normally when we want to receive a signal, we take a resonant antenna. And what does it mean? It means that the length of the antenna is half a wavelength. And for radio telescopes like OLFAR and LUFAR, it means that if we want to look deep into the universe and see something from the Big Bang, then we have to be between 30 kilohertz and 30 megahertz. And then if you look at the wavelengths, we are talking about wavelengths from 10 kilometers to 10 meters, which is huge. And especially here, the low frequencies are interesting, and it is totally impossible to have a half wavelength antenna of 5 kilometers in space. That does not work. So for example, Radio Astronomy Explorer 2 had a lambda, a wavelength of 64 meters. So that's why it had these long antennas. But now we want to have a swarm. And for a swarm, we want to make small satellites. And here you see an example of a small satellite that we launched 12 and a half years ago, called Delphi C3, a Delft student satellite that we were built. It has only a 13 centimeter antenna. And at the moment, there is a satellite ready for launch, which is Delphi PQ, which only has antennas of 17 centimeters. And this one has a radio astronomy payload on board. So a payload to look at the very low frequencies. The circuit that is in there is designed by Anton, who is teaching this course. And the circuit that is in there is also the circuit that you will be designing in the bonus assignment. So the circuit that will be the example in this course will be an antenna amplifier, an active antenna, as it's called, for radio astronomy. Let's have a closer look at what we want to build. So what we want to build is this antenna amplifier for radio astronomy. And the first setup that we want to build, of course, to test it, is build one on ground. And here you see what I mean with ground. This is the Delphi ground station. So on the roof of Amy, and you see different poles over there. And on one of these places on the roof, we want to have a little antenna with an antenna length of maybe half a meter or smaller that can receive those low frequency signals. Of course, it cannot do radio astronomy, but it can receive interference that we have. It can measure lightning and so on. And it is, of course, a perfect test. And here is the inside of the Delphi ground station. It is lower, of course. It is below the antenna park, and that's where the receivers are. And now we want to go from this antenna to the receiver with a cable. And this means that the whole system that we will be looking at in this course is this chain. So we have an active antenna. We have a 50 ohm cable, we have an interface, and then we go to the software defined radio over there. And this is the important part, and especially the cable is important for us, since it puts a challenge on this design. This amplifier should be able to drive this cable. So this is the design example of this course. This is what we are going to the design. So we are going to research the feasibility of this amplifier with an operational amplifier, and we will design one. And then we have the design challenge over here, this change, where we have this cable.